Today, we're going to try and demonstrate the elementary stages of color modeling in planes. It's how Hensche helps students to come to an understanding of the three-dimensional quality of forms and also the three-dimensional quality of the spatial relationships through relational color. Okay, we've restated the masses and worked them down into solid shapes so that they're clear basis for comparison. And now we're going to restate the masses once again. And when we get that done and get things a little better related, then we'll start the modeling process. I'm not showing all of the early stages of this because we've already covered that in earlier parts of this series about masses and variations. So this is just an extension of that, and the modeling is built on those parts. So you'll have to go back and look at those also after I get all of them posted. That should be sufficient for us to start our major variations, the beginning of modeling. Now that our masses are fairly decent, we'll go through the process called color modeling of the forms. Modeling of the forms simply means giving them the three-dimensional quality as their appearance has it as we see it. But on this two-dimensional flat plane, it has to be done with planes of color. And I guess a half a dozen airplanes. We'll have a longer talk about all the definitions and stuff at some other time. Right now, the light keeps getting away from us. The first and most obvious major variation or large modeling plane is the half-light plane. And it's called half-light plane because that's basically what it is. It's receiving roughly half the light that the full light plane is. And regardless of what you've read or been told by art teachers, the half-light plane does not belong to the shadow note. This has nothing to do with values. Non-existent values. It has to do with color contrasts. There is this note in light. This note is a shade plane. That was the overall aggregate impression. Now to make the shade plane and the sunlit plane more refined and more like what we see in nature, we have to start breaking each one of those large masses down into its major divisions. And as I said, that first division is the half-light plane. Now, of course, every section of that note that I just put in is a different color. There, there, there. Every time the form changes and the angle of light is hitting the form at a different angle, then that is a completely different color change. But your eye is not developed enough to run in and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It may never be, but we can get close to a lot of things. We might have seen that as 3 separate notes and got them fairly decent. But since y'all are new to this, you keep the motif on the board as simple as you possibly can, so that you don't, one thing, you don't get lost, and another, you don't put up a bunch of confusing colors that aren't there. Also added a little test note today. A test note, which is usually a small white object, so that the eye will always be able to register what the light key is, because it's most easily seen in its effect on the light plane of a white object or a white form. But you can also add something that's actually a pure color, like a flower, piece of fruit. I got a little sweet pepper I just picked. What that does is that pure note allows the eye to be able to compare and see how impure every other color is in your study. It's just a way to keep yourself checked. Well, your palette is also, it's obvious, you hold it up to your setup, you hold it up to your painting, and it's obvious that nothing out there is as vivid as some of the colors on your palette. And I know that this is going through quite a few people's minds. Why is his drawing so crude? Well, it's because the colors are still so crude. There's no reason to be fussing with all sorts of tight and what you think are really defined draftsmanship when your colors are in such a crude state. Every color has to be restated and restated and restated in relation to everything else until we arrive at a refined light key. And as you're doing that, your understanding of the shapes of each one of the colors becomes more obvious. And as you put in the correct shape of the color, that is the drawing. So the drawing comes up naturally at the same time that the color becomes more refined. You'll find that out if you stick with this and paint long enough. Okay, by having the half lights up, we have another basis of comparison so that it becomes obvious that the original note made for the light plane is actually only part of the light plane. It's pretty close to what the middle section is, but the far section, which is receiving a bit more light, is a little bit warmer. And you saw that it was a little bit warmer because the half light plane was so cool by comparison. I hate to use those terms, warm and cool. It's a different color. You got a pinky violet mauve laying next to an off warmish pink green. How's that? And all of that makes the outer note over here to appear as if it has a little more yellow or a little more orange or a little more burnt sienna in it. Not a lot, but enough to make it definitely different than the one next to it. And that's what all of this is about. It's about compare over and over and over again. Every time you put in any note, you have to compare it not only to the ones adjacent to it, but to every other note on your study. And here's three important things to remember. The note that will come between this light plane and this half light is not this note and that note smeared together. It's a completely different note that will not look like either one of them, but it will hold its place. The note that's between the shadow note and the half light, same thing. It's not those two notes mixed together and smeared together. Nor is an adjacent note a simple value change of its neighbor. And also, no colors repeat. No color will repeat anywhere in nature, and so you do your best to make sure that no colors ever repeat in your study. If they do, it's because your observations are off, not because nature has repeated herself. So no notes repeat. No adjacent note is a simple value change of either note on either side of it. And no two notes, adjacent notes, are smeared together to make the note between them, because that's a false note, because it wasn't made off of an observation. Okay, enough talking. That's called a sit-down note. Kind of like sit down, shut up. It's a tool to keep you from getting lost. Don't do that. Ruin your knife.